Welcome everyone to the panel on Internet of Things, Security and Privacy. I'm Siddharth. I'm a Ford Mozilla OpenWare Fellow at EDRI. And to begin with, let me give a very brief and very simple introduction of Internet of Things. So Internet of Things simply means enabling machines to talk to each other and with humans. Some argue that it makes our life very much easier as the machines know what exactly we want, whereas some complain that the internet-connected coffee machines have been taken part in the distributed denial service and they don't understand what it is, apart from the fact that they know that it has crashed many of the websites. It is true that entire physical environment which we live in is connected to internet and it somehow knows what we want, and it in a way can improve the quality of life. We can see the applications of IoT in transport, healthcare, waste management, manufacturing and whatnot. We often hear another word called big data, which is often heard in conjunction with Internet of Things. And big data simply means Internet of Things devices dump the lots and lots of data about ourselves, about our environment without our knowledge. And deriving useful insight from this dump is nothing but big data. Even though the Internet of Things, the phrase Internet of Things has the word things in it, I feel more it as a human-centric technology rather than a thing-centric technology. So IoT together with big data has led to many, many new inventions. For example, our cameras in our cell phones can detect our motions, and our watches can detect our pulse and tell us do we have any syndromes, or it can actually listen to the fluctuations in our emotions. Dr. Raslin Picard of MIT, a pioneer of emotional intelligent technology, calls this insight as true smile of happiness. Finding emotions through machines is true smiles of happiness. But according to me, giving away our life pattern in exchange of more targeted advertisement is not really kind of happiness that I'm looking for. The reason being privacy concerns and violation of human rights associated with connecting devices. We have an expert panel here to talk more on that. So without much further ado, let me introduce you guys to the panel. So we have Andreas Krisch, who is the president of European Digital Rights and the Austrian Forum Data Protection. In his professional capacity, he is managing director of NKSELT GmbH, an Austrian data protection consultancy. Andreas regularly contributes to the European discussion on data protection complaint adoption of information technology. He repeatedly provided his expertise on data protection, RFID and Internet of Things to institutions such as European Commission, the European Parliament and the Council of Europe and the OECD. Andreas significantly contributed to the Austrian court case that led to the abolishment of data retention derivative by ECG and its Austrian transportation by Austrian Constitutional Court. And then we have Katiza Rodriguez. Katiza is a EFF's International Rights Director. She concentrates on comparative policy of international policy issues with special emphasis on law enforcement, government surveillance, and cross-border data flows. Her work in EFF's international program also focuses on cybersecurity at the intersection of human rights. Katiza also manages EFF's growing Latin American programs. She is an advisor to UN Internet Governments Forum and a member of Advisory Board of Privacy International. Before joining EFF, Katiza was director of the International Privacy Program at the Electronic Privacy Information Center in Washington, D.C., where, amongst other things, she worked on the privacy and human rights reports and international survey of privacy law and developments. And we have Feike Jensen over there, the project lead at Tactical Tech. She researches and writes on politics of big data and digital shadows. She hopes to bring more transparency to global data industry. Prior moving to Berlin, Feike worked on intersection of the internet, social change, and security, working at HIVOS to set up and manage their digital emergency program for human rights defenders and activists. She also co-authored a book called Digital Alternatives. And then we have Finn Murstedt, who's the head of Digital Services Section at Norwegian Consumer Council, NCC. Focusing on national and international issues related to net neutrality, data protection, copyright, telecommunications, and more. And Finn is also the EU co-chair of Transatlantic Consumer Dialogue, TACD, Information Society Committee. And TACD has a network of over 75 leading organizations representing the consumer interests on both sides of Atlantic. So giving an introduction of which, let me brief about the format of this panel. So everyone will have their 10 minutes of talk about different topics related, different things related to IoT and privacy. And after that, we have a question answer session. And if you don't want to be recorded, you can just raise your hands and ask the questions from there. But if you don't mind that, you can come here and ask the question. So the panel will answer you. So to start with, Finn has an interesting gift for me, and Finn has a really good history of giving gifts to people. For example, his Christmas gift to one of the companies called as Genesis, he just gave a complaint for violating privacy. And apparently, like, he has a gift for me, the little doll sitting over there, and yeah. I have no clue what it does. Let's see.
So hello everyone, thank you so much for being here. I brought a little friend. Her name is Kayla. She was gift of the year a few years ago. She is connected to the internet, and your child can talk to her. It's amazing. And she can answer the questions that you ask her. So this is truly an interesting piece of toy we have here. I also have with me IQ, the robot, who focuses more on scientific questions. I'm told to move a little bit closer here. Focus a bit more on scientific questions about the Earth and the space. And so we have done in the Norwegian Consumer Council, which is a consumer rights organization, where I work on digital issues. We've done lots of research into internet connected devices. And I'm gonna talk a little bit about the research that we have done. But just to show you a little bit of what's possible with these amazing internet connected devices, I have now turned the Bluetooth on this doll, which means that anyone with a Bluetooth connection in this room have the ability of connecting to the toy, which is amazing. And we are going to show you a little experiment here. I've asked Sid in advance to do this. And let's see what interesting things you can do when you're connected to this doll via a Bluetooth connection from any random phone in this room, or maybe outside this room. So pretend I'm Sid's son, and I'm in my room playing. I forgot to turn the doll off, and I'm actually doing my homework. I'm sitting here doing my homework. I'm 5 years old, 6 years old. That's the target group of this doll. So let's see what happens when Sid starts having fun with his little phone.
All right, so I see a Bluetooth device called a Scala Party Time. And it sounds like I'm in a party mode, so let me connect to that. And I did. But for some reason, I'm into haunted house kind of music. So. Actually playing the video from here. So.
I'm scared. I don't know if you can hear it in the back, but basically, what I've shown you now is basically that anyone with a Bluetooth connection, unless the doll is paired with another Bluetooth connection, can connect to the doll, as long as you're in proximity of this doll. We discovered that when we did our research on internet-connected toys this last few months. I'm going to go through, as a case study, as an introduction to this panel, I'm going to just go through briefly the finds we did in this research, which I think is quite indicative of internet-connected devices coming on the market now and in the future, where we see a lot of companies who have not before worked in the digital field who are suddenly realizing we need to do something about this internet-connected stuff. And in this toy, in this story, we have looked at the toy industry, which is, traditionally speaking, are a very analog industry, which are now trying to stay relevant with kids after YouTube has taken over a lot of the child abilities. And I have to apologize to the camera. I have to stand over here because the cord isn't long enough. So I prepared a little presentation for you. So what we've done in the Norwegian Consumer Council, we've had a project for the last few months on the Internet of Things. In November, we published a study on internet-connected devices, fitness trackers to be specific, where we looked at both the terms of service and the technical characteristics of the fitness tracker. I can't move, the computer is here, I'm sorry. So basically what we discovered briefly there was that health data was being collected about users with extremely wide licenses. Basically the fitness trackers has a poor definition of what personal data is, which means in turn that they can do, from how we read the terms, more or less everything with this data. We therefore filed a dual complaint to both the Consumer Ombudsman in Norway and the Data Protection Commissioner against Fitbit, Jawbone, Garmin and Mio. Basically arguing that they were breaching European data protection law and consumer law. We are trying a very interesting principle here, because what we discovered was you can go to any sports store in your country and buy these devices. And if you ask one of the people working there, they have no clue about the security of the device, your rights as a consumer in case they shut down the service or sell the, which we've seen a lot of examples of, they sell their device or their company to someone else. What happens then? Can you still use the device? We've seen several examples of services just being shut down. We discovered there are no rights such as that. And also with the really poor definitions of personal data, they can basically use health data for a lot of unrelated things such as marketing or potentially in the future, we fear, let's say insurance. So that was really bad. You can read this study is available online. It's all in English. But the second part of, and we did one thing, just I'll show you also another way, a small thing we did in order to highlight, I think one of the major challenges with IoT, except security and privacy, obviously, and that's this thing which we then, we did a short video to highlight one of the challenges that we see related to this issue. Now, it's very interesting to see if the sound works.
Er du klar?
Ja, nå jeg klar.
Lykke til! Fitbit privacy policy, terms of service and privacy shield policy. This is contact and write to your privacy officer. Hvordan føler du det nå?
Nei, jeg er litt svett.
Får du noen gang satt deg i alle disse vilkårene du må takke ja til når du laster ned digitale tjenester eller treningssambo?
Jeg prøver jo å følge med da, men jeg skal være særlig innrømme at alt det som du har lest opp da, det har jeg ikke klart å sette meg inn i deg.
Nei, det er veldig krevende, men hva tenker du om disse lange
vilkårene? Basically, this is the conclusion.
I mean, it goes without saying that when you have a, and this, you know, you have, thank you, when you have a device like this and it takes you this long just to read the terms and condition on this little fitness tracker, it is completely ridiculous. In addition to this, even if you read the terms, they're impossible to understand. We used a technician, an IT expert, a lawyer, an economist, a political scientist, and we still don't understand what are in these terms and conditions. So that is challenge number one. With terms and conditions, even before you start using IoT devices, this is a major barrier to privacy, data protection, and other consumer rights. I'll turn off this awful thing. So, what we did with the toy issue, which I won't go into details because of the time restraints, we did the technical testing, which you just saw, and we had some disturbing results. We also did reading the terms of service of these toys. We also did Hello Barbie, but because that's not available in the European market, I'm not going to present that now. But these two toys, which are widely available all over Europe, we published this before Christmas so that it could have an impact on the Christmas sales. We thought that was important in order to, you know, stop these devices being sold. Because obviously we found some really disturbing things. We found unsecure Bluetooth connection, which is what we saw at the beginning. We also discovered voice data. So this thing is on now. We haven't connected it to the internet. Well, we connected it through Sid's phone, which basically means it could be recording right now. We also discovered that in order to track the data, we had to go with an IT specialist to see, do a man-in-the-middle attack to see what happens to the voice data. We discovered that the voice data was sent to a third party in the United States called Nuance, the world's largest voice recognition company, working also with companies such as Android. And you had to read the terms first of Kayla, and then you had to read the terms of Nuance, a company you didn't even know existed. And obviously the terms of service for, sadly, for both Kayla and Nuance were unacceptable according to both European law, but also US law. So there are several people in this room from the US side. I'm looking at Kathy over there. She's working for a Center for Digital Democracy, and we did a excellent work with her and also many other organizations. In total, 25 organizations from the consumer network joined us in filing complaints in 10 to 15 countries simultaneously on the 6th of December, just before Christmas. And the impact was quite massive. Amazon stopped selling the doll, and Toys R Us in the US also stopped the sale before Christmas. And in Belgium and in Netherlands, they stopped the sales, and in Scandinavia, consumers could get a refund. Because what we found was so disturbing, and due to time constraints, I'm gonna just leave you basically with this. So we saw the voice data being sent to third parties with very wide licenses. The terms were unacceptable on many, many accounts. And also we discovered when we hacked the app itself, and we could download the pre-programmed speech, we also discovered what is most likely hidden marketing. Because we discovered that the company Genesis and Toy Quest, who are behind this doll, also have commercial relationships with companies such as Disney. Disney has later gone out and said they have nothing to do with this, but we did see a lot of preference for Aladdin movies and the Little Mermaid movies when asking questions to Kayla, what is your favorite movie? So there were a lot of unanswered questions, and obviously the security issue was a massive problem, which basically means anyone could connect to the doll. And we saw necessary to file complaints with several authorities. And we did lots of technical testing. We worked together with an external IT company to do the hacking. We tested the range of the Bluetooth. We tested inside, outside to see how far away you need to be. And obviously, this is first generation toys. Bluetooth is getting better and better. The range increases. So the problems that we have discovered here, which you could say is limited. I mean, if you have the dog here, you can probably connect through this wall, but not the next wall. But Bluetooth next year might be much better in terms of reach. So this problem, we think, will only increase. And there are lots of things they could have done to avoid this, and they didn't do this. They could have added physical access to the doll. Actually, Hello Barbie does this. You need to actually be with the doll to connect. So if Sid was an evil, evil person, he had to come next to me to connect to it. And if obviously the doll is in the house of someone. So I think if someone else is in your house, you have a bigger problem than them connecting to this doll. So that would have easily have avoided this security problem. And you could have easily had a password on this doll the first time you connect, and many other things you could have implemented in order to secure this doll. And this company didn't do it. And the disturbing part was that they knew what they were doing. We've done some research into the specific Bluetooth technology they use on this doll, and it's basically really bad stuff. When we looked at what is written about this specific Bluetooth technology, it's basically commonly known. I'm not an IT expert, but this is what the IT expert says. To make user experience easier and to have accepted the increased risk of security attacks using this type of Bluetooth security. And this is a doll, a toy for kids. So we find it very, very disturbing. And it's not like this has not been discovered before. We discovered when we did our research that what these security problems were discovered in January 2015. And still, they were being heavily promoted around the world for Christmas sales 2016 December. So this is clearly a company who does not take security, privacy, and all these other issues into consideration. So these are the commercial relationships. This is basically all the companies that are involved in the value chain related to this doll. I mentioned Nuance, the security, which is also a security contract for the US government and other governments working on intelligence. And these, with the voice, with the wide user terms they have, there are basically no limitations from our point of view, which then resulted also in EPIC, Center for Digital Democracy, filing a separate complaint on the same day to the Federal Trade Commission in the US, based basically on one of these issues. So that's why we did a joint effort. I mentioned international cooperation. We did also an interesting, we tried also in all these countries we worked in to also file complaints to data protection consumer authorities, but also product safety authorities, because this is also a product safety issue. And what we discovered, there is no product safety legislation for the Internet of Things. So product safety directive in the European Union, for example, does not have standards covering basic security for the Internet of Things. So this is an issue I think we need to work on going forward here in the Europe, but probably also in other countries around the world. So I'll leave you with that. We basically see that legislation currently is not good enough. Surprise, surprise. Security and privacy by design is not respected. Consumers lack control. I mean, in the user interface, through the terms of condition, etc. Purpose limitation that you can't use for data for other things than what you're actually giving it for, clearly shown in this case, it's not really being respected. Responsibility is eroded. You can't go to the store and complain. They say, hey, we didn't do it. You know, we're just selling you the device. You go to the company who made the service, hey, you need to relate to the third party provider of the voice service. Come on, it's completely ridiculous. So we're now testing with one of our complaints the issue of equipment criterion, which basically means we can hold the company responsible in the country where you bought the device. And this is now currently being going through the mail with the Data Protection Authority in Norway. And which, if it's found in our favor, it will also be for the European, all European area. So that's it. We also see an issue with competition law. Digital monopolies weaken the competition in this area. We need more competition. We see a race to the bottom, and we're going to probably go over this with all the other speakers. So this is just a case study on toys, but I think it's applicable to a lot of internet-connected devices and services. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Frank. And it's indeed scary that how these connected devices are leading us to an unknown players, and we don't know what they do with the data. And especially the lack of security and privacy has been researched in many other cases, for example, fitness trackers. And I would like to point out to one of the research done in Citizen Lab called as Every Step You Fake. And I could run in one day 1,000 kilometers, and just by doing man in the middle attacks, and it's like ridiculously broken. And so one of the reason, one of the turnaround for this problem, for the security and privacy, is lack of human interruption. And let's see what Fika has to tell more on how users should be knowledgeable about this, or what is their responsibilities concerned with this.
Oh. Hi, everybody. I hope you can hear me in the back. I think some of my, in the previous thing, there was some issues. But so I just want to frame it a bit, because Finn comes from a consumer rights organization, so his sort of vantage points comes from this. I come from Tactical Tech, which is an NGO based in Berlin, and we work sort of with the end user, or, well, basically human rights defenders and activists, and we mainly focus on privacy and digital security. So a lot of sort of the things I bring up, and also the thinking around it, also comes from this vantage point, so it's a very specific one. And so with the Internet of Things, some of the things that I just want to, it's more maybe posing challenges and giving answers like Finn does, but I want to focus on the user, on critical design, and maybe some larger challenges in which this all fits. And as Finn already mentioned, in the terms of service, which takes over 11 kilometers in running to read, the user is increasingly made responsible for digital security and privacy. And you not only see that with the terms of service, but for instance also in the Netherlands with online banking, if your browser is out of date and your bank account gets hacked, you're actually responsible and the bank is not. It's questionable if this is legal, but this is the way it's being presented. So the user is becoming increasingly more responsible for all the actions they're taking. But nobody ever asks questions who this user is. And we do a lot of sort of privacy and digital security trainings all around the world. And so to sort of get a baseline of where people are, like what is people's technical or abilities and skills to understand what this internet, whether it's Internet of Things or a mobile phone actually means, we ask them to draw the internet. And you'd be surprised how often people draw stars, clouds, very interesting manifestations of what an internet is, but hardly anybody draws a physical infrastructure. Clouds is the majority thing that people draw because this has been the metaphor that we give people. Everything is in the cloud is like somewhere in the air and it's secure. So this is how people think of it. And it's very difficult to then start thinking about your privacy and security if your mental image is a cloud and not a fact that it's actually copper wires or glass fiber cables running through the ground and there's different actors who actually have access to it. Then another thing what I find interesting is, and like many people here are probably quite they're scholars or they're like people working on internet issues, but even like when you talk to people and say, why should I care about my privacy or digital security? They always say, it's just this one-off data point. Who cares about this one email, the content of it, or this one check-in on Foursquare? This is like the most common answer we get back. And it's like, to take this bridge, it's actually not about the one-off data point, but that it's about the entire set of things. So that is what people are interested in, because you need the entire data set to start figuring out patterns. You can do it in nifty tricks like your iPhone has a recollection of all your location history and it's sort of their algorithm then shows you back where you live. And this is quite eye-opening to everybody I talk to who hasn't seen it, because we still think in individual data points when we talk about sort of our data ways that we spread. And then for a project we just created, it was sort of like a gimmick, we created a data detox kit, and it's an 8-day step and you get to play around with it. So now we are sort of reading all these articles about people who've used it or people are like responding to us on Twitter. And it's actually quite funny, like even tech journalists, the thing they said was, I thought it was all fine because I have my two-factor authentication on, which is very important, but then we forget our entire other scale of our data exhaust, where we keep on like broadcasting who we are, what we do, our health state, everything. So it's not, this person who draws clouds is not the stupid user in the corner or your mom who doesn't understand anything. I think we, in general, users have a very limited understanding of how the entire ecosystem works because it's very complex. And yet, while the user sort of remains here, because there's also a lack of education to people, there's a lack of public awareness raising on a lot of issues related to privacy and security, you see that commercial and government surveillance just increases, it skyrocketed. Like the crap they come up with to sort of like break things to get access to our data, the things they come up with to just like get more access to it from a commercial vantage point so they can sell it, it's fascinating, and the user stays here. And I think this is quite important, that you see like commercial and government surveillance skyrocketing and the user remains sort of at this knowledge level. So then, if we're not investing in education or in sort of awareness raising, then are we investing in? There's a lot in Europe especially, there's a lot of like investment in policies. I think one interesting point can also be critical design or critical engineering. I do think we need to have a critical discussion about what this all means. And what I find sort of maybe saddening, or maybe I'm not talking to the right people, this could also be it, but when the internet got started, we had this amazing community who believed in free and open source software, who believed that there should be alternative to commercial products, who believed in certain security standards. And sort of with the introduction of the mobile phone, all of a sudden there are two main platforms that everybody uses, and the alternatives are things that are built on top of these platforms. So already centralized in sort of two main centralizations. And you can say, okay, there's some alternatives out there. I've tried to use them. They're in general difficult. And now one of the biggest alternatives got sold to Microsoft. So you can question if it's an alternative. And then now, if you see like the third trend, which moves into the Internet of Things, if I've been reading up about the Internet of Things, and either it's like, hooray, this is amazing, I can get a smart thermostat in my house, I can get like, I can I can hook up to devices and watch my children while I go, I don't know, to the library across the street. Like, there's a lot of probably good things about it, but I haven't yet been introduced to the critical engineering community who, when the Internet got started, was there. There's a lot of people in the maker community who are trying to do alternative IoT stuff, but it lacks sort of the political dimension that used to be in the free and open source software foundation. Because even today, like in the opening of the first panel, and I think this is also where, I mean, we have to politicize also what's happening in these trends, is that somebody today here in this group said, we live in a post-privacy world anyway, as a joke. But we actually take over the rhetorics of the people who are trying to sell us this. And this is what I find problematic, that we're not critical about using this, we live in a post-privacy world. The people who created this is the 1% of the 1%. They make billions of money of us believing this. And just by even in like a community like this, just regurgitating what Silicon Valley tells us is true, I find it very problematic, because we have to be political and critical, and we have to also question these things. Why is it okay to live in a post-privacy world? For me, it's not okay. So then if it's not okay, maybe we can start taking some actions on it. And I think you can see certain tweaks, like it's about being critical and about being responsible. And it's not only the tech engineers, it's also about, for instance, designers in the process. There's a very famous self-driving car company. I will not name the name, but one of the designers was talking to the director of the organization I work for, and they said they found a flaw in the design, and this would mean a highly unlikelihood that it could kill somebody. I mean, in the end, they're cars, so it can still kill people. And so they were a bit uneasy about it, and so they went to the legal department, because apparently this is what you do. And legal said, it's more expensive to fix this problem than to pay the people off who, like the families of the people who died. So it becomes an economic incentive. And so the designers went back and they were like, I don't know if we can live with it. So they actually went back and fixed the problem. So I think having like critical people within the engineering and designing community who actually do think this is political and who do see problems in this is crucial. And the question is, how do we reach out to them and how do we start the conversation? Or maybe there are already these pockets and we're completely in silos, which is not uncommon in the internet. So now come to some challenges. So some of the things I've been thinking about is governability. If you look at the sheer size of Internet of Things, I mean the amount of devices that will be connected in the next 10 years alone, like how do you govern it? And maybe, I mean, in the panel before I was quite critical about transparency, even though it was said in my introduction. I think it's like I think especially in Europe we have quite a big leeway to push back. So also from a policy standpoint, how do we govern these devices? We can take them out of the market. We can also see like how is it affecting certain groups that we don't want it to affect, because we all know that the negative consequences of data, the negative consequences of IoT will not be the heterogeneous community in Europe. They will be the migrants, the children, they will be the people who may already be on the fringes. So how, from a governing point of view, how can we say this is the bottom line and below things are not acceptable, and where do we draw this line? And so there's a lot of questions about it, but I think just saying that companies are responsible or that we have to open up the code so that we can see what's happening, I think we're beyond that point and we have to look at different interactions to do this. Also, I'm quite fascinated about the trends where it's going with the sheer size of things as well. Like, if billions of devices get connected to the internet, maybe the super centralized application model that we currently live in, where we have a few big companies who provide the platforms, the software, who provide everything, will not hold anymore, because it will just become too expensive to automatically update. I mean, you already see that Android has a problem with this because of the distributed model in which it's been set up. So then it will probably refer back to device-to-device communication. So it can, I mean, it's not only an ethical, like an ethical question, what happens when devices communicate with each other and no longer with the users or with the people, but what also happens when, for instance, you outsource things to devices that are otherwise very costly in a decentralized manner. And that might be that your Barbie will be updated by the neighbor's Barbie, but that also means that there it will be horizontal data exchange, which will lead to another a lot of other ethical and problematical questions that we need to think about. So I like to think a little bit about what is in the front. And maybe one of the last points, because then I'll be talking for a while. I also think we have to frame IoT in the social and political context that it's taken place in. So a lot of our framing around technology comes from Silicon Valley. The way we approach IoT also comes from America, because it's getting big there. But it's very much from a consumer standpoint. So say you have Internet of Things related to smart meters. So we have Google Nest. I mean, I've seen some really creepy advertising from Google Nest in the US. But it's a very consumer-driven product. So at the moment, you still make a choice whether you buy it or not. If I look at the Netherlands, for instance, it's very different. Smart meters are rolled out as sort of, they're being pushed by the government, because it's a complex ecosystem. Electricity, they say that because of a lot of the natural energy that's coming, the grid cannot take all these fluxes, so we need smart meters in every house to sort of make the smart grid or the electricity grid more stable. It's fine. And what I enjoy about the discussion, so there's a different model, because it's centralized, centrally pushed, and I think next year every house needs to be connected to a smart meter in the Netherlands. So I mean, this is it's very different than you go to a store and you buy a consumer product. So I think this is a social political situation in Europe that is not only in the Netherlands, but I think in most European countries by now, where the Internet of Things is like pushed in your house. But what is also nice about this example from the Netherlands is that 3 years ago I was talking to somebody who works for one of the energy companies, and he's a security engineer, and he thought, I actually don't want one of these things in my house. So how can you still make a smart grid work without having a smart meter in your house? And actually the solution was quite simple. You put it at street level, not at household level, or street level. And this, by default, it's not a perfect solution, but it gives you already some a little bit more privacy. So I think like this, there's a lot of sort of non-technical solutions and creative critical engineering decisions that people can make, and designer decisions that actually push back this sort of tidal wave of IoT things that are coming across us. Maybe I'll leave it at that.
All right, thank you. So listening to your both talks, I see there are like two problems. One is, as I told, lack of human interruption. Probably that can be solved in the case of toys with a button where you make manually press it. But IoT is even more deeper than that. IoT is just minimalistic, very minimalistic design. It comes with just sensors and no visible UX, and which means it is difficult to get meaningful consent from the users. Where she rightly pointed out that there's a highly increased responsibility on the users to know what it is doing, and the problem with hidden marketing agenda behind it. I'm just wondering that what governments could legally get from these IoT devices, and also if you can touch base about the invisible user interface problem. So the floor is yours, Katisa.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Okay, I will talk a little about the sick. I will talk. I forgot we don't have. I will speak strong and slowly. I want to talk, touch base a little about the security problems around the Internet of Things. But I will start with just the first slide with putting an example of a smart about the privacy in the home. I start with a quote from Kylo at a US decision in 2001 about thermal imaging cases, which says that in the home, our cases show all details are intimate details, because the entire area is held safe from prying from government eyes. But I think all consumer advocates looking at Internet of Things in the home have eyes on what kind of data or what kind of household activities the government could obtain from these kind of devices or vendors who use illegal processes. Smart meters is just one good example. A few years ago, the next one please, a company in Europe, Siemens, has usually summarized why smart meters represent a privacy threat. Well, you say, we, Siemens, have the technology to record every minute, second, microsecond, more or less live. From that, we can infer how many people are in the house, what they do, whether they are upstairs, downstairs, do you have a dog, when do you habitually get up, when did you get up this morning, when do you have a shower. It's a lot of masses of private data. So from ovens to garage doors, to insulin pumps, to vehicles or dolls, many of our devices are going to be connected to the internet in the same sense that our phones are now. This is only going to get things worse. And to understand, because we always talk about futuristic things, about the Internet of Things, but what I did is try to go back of what was the future house seeing in 1957. So we could say, what is the house of the future, but in 1957? And in that moment, next, they were saying that the house of the future was a 3D color TV wall panel. Hey, we got it. House control panel. Hey, we got it. Dust-free floors. Yes, we can sweep them. Phono vision receiver, like FaceTime. Menu selectors, giant-sized fruit, and still waiting for my personal helicopter and roof landing area. Not still yet. Next one. So how was the house of the future from 1977? And they said the housewife of the future won't have to worry about dishpan hands. Control center will allow the housewife to keep an eye on her sleeping baby, produce meals with a minimum of food handling, wash dishes without handling them, shop and bank. That's true. No, that's very futuristic in 1977. Let's go. And what was the home of the future in 2006 as imagined in 1996? And that's what the media was saying. Personal diagnostic of machine, like an Apple Watch, that check your health info and suggest menus, even encourage you to exercise. Not too far, in 2007, we have Fitbit. And so what is the house of the future now, they said, as imagined for 2025? So this is the house of the future. Guest body heat regulates temperatures during the game. A smart fridge auto-order supplies via your grocery app 3 days ago, and hash flash chilling compartment for beers, preheat the car from your home. Security systems are integrated with all the devices so you can see who's outside from your TV or your fridge. Toilets have sensors to detect what is in them and flush accordingly. Why is still the woman in the kitchen doing something? Okay, so the Internet of Things tends to exacerbate this massive data collection. And just many thoughtful security researchers have been talking about that even back to what it was RFID, which they will do, and I will just identify some of the major concerns. One is like an obtrusive automatic data collection. Just a few examples, if you can see. We can see sleeping patterns and earthquakes. In 2014, in Napa Valley, there were a huge earthquake, and everyone who was doing jawbone wake up at 3:20 for that for the earthquake. So you were able to notice that with the aggregation of the data. Yeah. But that was from a single device. Let's go next one. What if many companies collect your data? What about when you combine devices, either through third-party interfaces, you know? And what happened, go again, if one company collects all your data and then they keep buying, because Google bought Wave in 2013 and they got Nest in 2014, and Nest bought Dropcam in 2014, and there are each different privacy policies, and some of them promise something, but then they change. This is not about like just Internet of Things oscillator. There is a big data, and just as the guy from General Electric says, big data is an understatement. In the near future, we will be talking about infinite data. And this is from the General Electric guy. And the same was from US government, Petraeus. He said, the Internet of Things will have a transformational effect on clandestine tradecraft and will change our notions of secrecy. Next. So what are the challenges in security? And yes, we'll try to identify some of them. Some of them already have been mentioned. But one of them is tracking and IDs. So IoT devices can also make much more easy to associate data with particular individuals. We're already seeing how smartphones and other technologies devices have specific IDs, like your email or your IMC or your Bluetooth or your MAC address. And we are going to see this more and more and more for all IoT devices that will track you where you go. So we will have all the location privacy problems that we already have, but even more exacerbated for the lack of security. And which is this lack of security that I want to mention? Some of the devices are being developed by companies that do not have high expertise on security, because their specialization is elsewhere. Like, they are good on making kitchens, they are good on making fridge, but they are not good on technology necessarily, because they don't have even a security team. If just security is hard for those who have a security team and staffers and knowledge, it's much, much harder for those who are not on the business and security. And this brings a lot of problems, you know, because, so one of the problems is, well, when you're using your computer, you know that you have to update, or at least it's getting more and more popular to know that you have to update your browser if there is a vulnerability. But if when you see at all, you're not imagining that this internet, that you need to do update for software vulnerability. And hence, it's much difficult. But when they hack those devices, they are not hacking just the toaster of Angela Merkel. They will hack the toaster of all Germans in the country. And that's the problem. And these large, this security is already hard for these companies, but also is, the Internet of Things companies are not planning necessarily to update these software vulnerabilities because they haven't think about it. This is already a problem with computers and mobile devices. Some of the updates, for instance, for Android doesn't get pushed. And this is a problem for Wi-Fi routers and smart TVs, but sometimes the Internet of Things are in firmware, so you don't have to update a software, you have to replace the firmware, which is harder, or you have to develop a software that push updates to firmware, but that's not even considered in the design of these devices. And that makes things much more complicated than the normal security problems that we have with all our digital devices. Then we have user interface problems. It's not that we have a keyboard, it's not that we have something in the case of the doll. Sometimes they are putting things in the cloud, and this is creating another set of problems about the security and information that those companies are being stored about what you're saying. If they are listening to everything what you're saying and just recording what you actually, if you call Alexa to do something, or you could Google Echo to do something, just they are recording in that moment, but to do so they have to listen to everyone, and you know, and they are sending the information when you talk to Alexa, sending to the cloud, and they bring all the privacy and security concerns around storing data on the cloud. And so just to finalize, because I don't have too much time, we also have to think about the government wanting to get this data, you know. Always want to get more data that is more private. And we already have in the case a case that we call it in the EFF, the company case. We don't know who is the company. It's a case in which law enforcement got a warrant to approach a company which make bill-in cases for telephone, to call via telephone, satellites, in case of emergency from the dashboard of your car. And the government want to compel the company to allow this software to listen to what is happening in the car. The device was only 2 call in case of emergency. You have an emergency, you call, hey, calling this, calling the helpline, you know? And the only reason the judge didn't allow this to go farther, the argument was that it was not possible to have the line on and at the same time being able to do an emergency call. And that's why the main purpose was emergency call, and that's why they rejected. But this raised a lot of concerns about, hey, so law enforcement can come and knock at the door and compel all these Echo or Google companies to actually turn on by default these listening machines. That's really scary, at least from my point of view. And I just want to close this here, because.
Right, so let's give a big round of applause for Pooja. And definitely the future home, I see it as a metadata nightmare. And also, like, the most of the IoT companies are not necessarily the internet experts, which is evident from the lack of updates, and hence the security vulnerabilities will persist. So, but she had a really nice point that law enforcement, or laws in general, can probably protect us. And Andreas, who has been through different stages of evolution of discussion on IoT data protection, probably thinks that self-regulation doesn't work, and we don't trust the liabilities, but we need proper data protection and consumer rights. Mm-hmm. So the floor is yours.
Thank you. Well, yeah, I would like to address the topic from a policy point of view. 10 years ago, in 2007, I had the interesting opportunity to be member of the European Commission's expert group on RFID. These are these tiny computer chips that are attached to your clothing when you buy new things, and where you are supposed to remove it after you bought something. I'm sure all of you do this properly. And the discussion in this expert group was about what it means for data protection if we attach RFID tags and ID technology to everything, everyday goods like clothing, like shoes, like don't know what, this bottle of water or this cup or whatever, and what follows from that, and how can we address the data protection and privacy issues that stem from this use of technology. We had a really lengthy discussion there. It took 2 years, the whole expert group, where we worked on all of these different views from industry, from computer, from consumer protection, from civil society, people like me, from data protection authorities, and so on, everybody in one room, and we exchanged views on how best to address this topic, and if there is a problem at all, or if it's all just overdoing and things like that. And after 2 years discussion, the European Commission came to the conclusion that it was best to do three things, basically. The first was that they issued a recommendation, a European Commission recommendation on RFID in 2009, which was more or less one of the main outcomes of the expert groups, where we discussed the text intensively and things like that, where it is recommended that RFID devices are turned off at the point of sale, that the operators do privacy impact assessments before they deploy the technology, things like that, and that they should place a special sign on products that are equipped with RFIDs, but also to areas where RFID readers are operated, so that people can be aware that there is such a technology and they can do whatever they see fit to answer this use of technology. And the recommendation of the Commission was published in 2009, and the standardization institutions were mandated to develop a sign to display that there is RFID technology. So to implement this recommendation of the European Commission, also the standardization bodies were asked to do the work of standardizing this sign, so that we have one European sign for RFID technology that should be used. And the third thing was that in the expert group, we also developed a framework for how to do privacy impact assessments for RFID technology that was sent to the Article 29 working party, who had a very critical look at it, gave recommendations what should be done better and what should be improved. And we had a second version that was then finally where the Article 29 working party said, okay, yes, this is a way how we can do it if you additionally do this and that. And finally, after 2 years of work, we had a recommendation, we had the privacy impact assessment framework, and we had a sign. The sign came a little bit later, but let's say it was there in 2009. And then industry was asked to voluntarily use all of these things that we produced, and also to involve civil society when they plan to introduce RFID systems. And the governments have been asked to do something about the technology and raise awareness in industry and so on. And that was it. Then we continued starting from 2010 with another expert group, a high-level expert group this time, because the topic was so important, on the Internet of Things, where we started to do the same discussion more or less, not only about RFIDs, but the Internet of Things as a more broader topic. And I had the honor to chair the privacy working group in this expert group. And basically, we came to the conclusion that the best thing you can do for data protection in the Internet of Things environment, and the most obvious thing to do, of course, is simply to comply with data protection law. Because this is simply what you need to do when you're going to process personal data. And there is not much magic about there other than doing just exactly that, what is requested by the law. And the discussion evolved not that good and that constructive as it was in the RFID expert group. And at some point in time, the European Commission decided to just shut down this expert group without any results and to deal with some other things other than IoT privacy and data protection. And so we had 5 years, 6 years of discussion. We had some results. And until today, I hardly see any example of having this work used in practice. There are two or three privacy impact assessments that have been done by companies, but I think that's basically it. And I was really, really surprised last year when I was at the Digital Assembly in Bratislava last year, event organized by the presidency, EU presidency, the Slovakian EU presidency. There have been also discussions about the Internet of Things, and we need to do something about privacy and fundamental rights protection and things like that. And it turned out that there actually now, or at the time last year, was an expert group of the European Commission where they actually discussed data protection in the Internet of Things and what one could do about it. And one of the great solutions that have been discussed there was to create a trust sign where you can label products that actually apply with data protection law. So as it seems, 10 years after, the same discussion is going on and on and on again and turning in circles with the same things discussed all the time. We need a trust sign, I don't know what other placebos, but as it seems, the solution is never to just comply with the law. And I think this is one of the main points that we need to take away from these 10 years of policy discussion, that what we actually need is proper law enforcement in data protection and in consumer rights. Because I do really not understand how it comes that it is accepted by policymakers, but also in the general public and the courts, that contracts with 40 pages and more, where everybody knows that first, nobody is reading them, second, nobody is able to understand them, are considered to be legally binding. This is, I can't understand that. How can a legal text that I do not understand, where everybody knows that nobody is reading it, be legally binding and allowing being a legal basis for data processing and data transfers to third countries and the processing of sensitive data. I think this just needs to be challenged to do something about it. And if we look at the scale and then on the impact of all of this, we are talking about the smart home and the future home of 2025. We are talking about these dolls. We are talking about some other fancy technologies that are supposed to make our lives easier. But we are talking about intelligent transport systems. So every move we make, every transport, every train, every bus, every car, every bicycle, what have you, will be connected. It was already discussed in 2010 in the expert group that all of these things should operate together. The road companies, highway companies, are equipping their roads with all of this stuff to monitor and to steer the traffic that is using their infrastructure, and to connect to the cars and tell them how to slow down, to drive faster, to leave the motorway, whatever. And these things increasingly are entering a phase where they become critical infrastructure, where they are so deep in our environment that if they get manipulated, if they get hacked, there is severe damage. Because if you manage to hack intelligent cars, autonomous cars, you can block the traffic of an entire city. This is quite possible by placing five cars at the right points in the city, by blocking the main roads. And I think this is something that we need to address. We need to have some inspections on how this technology actually works, if it is implemented in a proper way, in a compliant way, and what is going on with all of this. One example: we also have smart TVs, for example, to come back to the consumer area. We had one case, I think, last year. It was with the smart TV that was listening to every word that was said in the room. This is has been a quite a troubling thing for people who have their TV in the living room, but I think even more worrying for those who have it in the bedroom, to having the TV listening to everything that was going on and broadcasting it to some company to analyze it. And things like that. So I think the first thing we need to do is to have proper data protection and data protection law enforcement for all those products that are already in the market. And I think the general data protection regulation will help us with that, but it still takes 1.5 years for it coming into practice. And we also need data protection impact assessments that are done properly, which is also starting from then. But what I do not see now is who is going to enforce it. When I have a look on how data protection agencies are equipped nowadays, I don't see that they have the staff to do all of this work. So we also need to think where we can get the money to finance all of this, and how we can get it focused on the right thing. So I think from the policy discussions, I wouldn't spend too much time on discussing new things, but I think the important and urgent thing to do is just to proper implement the things that we have. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Andres. We have seen this topic of Internet of Things, privacy and security from different point of views. For example, Finn started with consumer rights point of view, and Faker gave a technology point of view, and we saw the law enforcement point of view, and then the human rights point of view. So I would like to ask you guys to fire up the debate with your questions and different point of views to see where it goes. One request: that you have to come here and speak in the mic because it's being recorded. So if you don't want it, just raise your hands and ask the question from there, and I can repeat it here. Thank you. All right.
I'll have one question.
Do you mind? Or
so what do you want me to do? Do I do it like?
No,
it's fine.
Yeah.
It's fine. I'm standing here. So I have one question. You basically said two things that seemed like to contradict each other. On the one hand, you said that companies were basically violating the GDPR when making all these devices, and it's an enforcement problem. And then basically in the next sentence you said, well, you know, the problem is that there's all these like terms and conditions that people have to agree with. And if they agree with it, sort of implicitly, it seems that then the companies do comply with the GDPR. So where is the real problem, or is it both a separate problem? Can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, I don't think that's a contradiction, because what I'm questioning is if the terms and conditions are really legally binding. I doubt that, because they are too long, they are not understandable, nobody reads them. Everybody knows that they are not read, and you can write anything in there, and it has simply no effect, because people want to have this doll, they want to play with it, they want their child to have fun with it, and their child only want this one because it's looking so nice. And nobody is taking a decision based on if the terms and conditions that are connected to this doll are fine or not. Nobody cares about that. So my point is that these terms and conditions are not binding, because they simply do not come into force. And then there is a violation of the data protection law, be it the current directive or the GDPR, because then there is no basis for the processing, there is no basis for data transfers to third countries, and so on.
But if the terms and conditions would be very, very simple, then probably people would still accept them. Then your argument would no longer hold.
Provided that you get the informed consent with emphasis on informed, where you need to tell them what exactly is going to be processed, what is going to be done with the data, when it will be deleted, and so on and so on. All of this information is not provided to the consumers in an effective way, in a way that they can understand.
All right, go ahead.
Having opened a bit the field, because I have a problem with Internet of Things being, while I respect very much larger consumer attacks, and I think they're very important, but I have a problem being presented as a consumer project. I think it is, Internet of Things now is highly developing in cities, intercities networks. It is developed by the states, enforced by the states in a way that doesn't respect the most basic civil respect. And we still see it as a door that is problematic. The door is problematic, but the problem is really on the larger infrastructural scale. As far as I know, when European Commission funds Internet of Things projects, they do it on very large scale, and they don't take into account privacy as a criteria of judgment for the funding of the project. So it means that from the beginning, privacy is not a concern in the development of an infrastructure of the Internet of Things, which is an infrastructural problem. On the security side, we've seen a number of DDoS attacks this year coming from Internet of Things objects, proving that the impossibility of address security, and those things need to be voiced a lot more strongly, and taking the idea of Internet of Things out from the sole consumer market. Mm-hmm. It's only the top of the iceberg, really.
All right.
You guys have any comments on that, or?
I agree. yeah, I agree. And just as an example, we looked into public websites of local municipalities last month. And we checked them for trackers, and we realized like local municipalities, so that could be the commune of Skarbek, where we're now in Brussels, have their own website. And we discovered they had like 20 trackers. And we made this public, and we wondered, asked the local municipalities, 400 of them in Norway, why are you have all these trackers? They had no idea. So they've just, you know, said, we need a website. And they outsourced it. And of course, in the criteria, there was no issue, no focus. And we looked through the criteria of public procurement,
And the only thing it said was like, you need to have a privacy policy. That was the only requirement for privacy they had in public procurement documents. And I'm sure that your point exactly, which is about public, for example, smart cities, if this is the you know, transcript they're following, then yeah, we're in big trouble, and we need to do a lot of work on that. I'm just working in the consumer organizations, so I focus on that, but I think you're completely right. There's a huge issue out there.
Yeah. I also think you're completely right, and especially in the entire, let's create smart cities, this is quite problematic. And I do think, like, I don't know Brussels that well, but if I look at the Dutch political context, for instance, when we talk about, I was talking to somebody at the Ministry of Economic Affairs, and we were talking about the lack of digital security expertise in the Netherlands. Like, it's become to a point where our internal secret services are hiring Italian technical staff to do the digital security for the secret service, which makes it quite weird because it's a national secret service. But there's not enough competencies in the country to do it. And so that's then also problematic for smart cities and IoT.
Come on.
What?
In the Netherlands, there's no security experts? Come on.
Apparently not enough if they're hiring outside for a national secret
service. Add something to your thing. You were talking about critical engineering and IoT, and you didn't find anything about it.
There's a lot.
There's DAOs. It's a Dutch product. Come on. Look up. Look around. Criticalengineering.org. What links to it? DAOs.
I will look at
further elaborate on what is the project.
Yeah, please.
The project is
a few words for
the router that you put on the ISP router, which is in your home but is owned by the ISP. This is the first problem. Then you have this box that is yours, that is free software, that is free hardware, and that looks at everything that's connected and going through your network. And then it makes it visible to you. So you can be aware of it and do whatever you want with it, or make it not work, for example. You know, Julian Oliver did this Glasshole.
Mm-hmm.
You know this project? So Glasshole is a program that detects Google Glass by its MAC address, because the MAC address has the vendor, which is in this case Google, and then you know that this is a Google Glass device, and then it attacks it so that it disconnects.
I think there is a fundamental problem with this approach. It's important to have technology to find out what is going on, to see how things work, etc. But the problem is that even if you are knowledgeable about technology, if you know what all of this means, your resources to devote time to finding out what is actually going on are always limited. And if I need to personally find out what is going on around me technologically all the time, when I enter a bus, when I drive a car, when I watch TV, when I play with a doll, with my children, etc., then I'm only busy with checking my environment and getting paranoid by all the things that I'm finding. So I think we need to organize our society differently. We need to organize our society in a way where things work like they are expected to work. And what we expect from things is that they do the obvious things and not 100 things in addition that are not obvious and that nobody is expecting. And therefore, I think it's important that if a doll needs to have or has an additional feature of talking to your children, then there can be the option to enable that knowingly what you are doing. After having been informed and having been told what is going on, you can use it. Of course you can. If it's fun for your children, why not? But you need to know that. And the environment, the doll needs to be produced in a way that you can have the choice. And not you need to monitor your environment if there is some additional things that are doing the wrong things.
Yeah.
All right, so before we conclude, probably we're running out of time, so you can catch them during the lunch break probably. Before we conclude, I would like to thank all the panelists, and it's a pleasure.